there were days and weeks where I couldn't even talk because like I had to try to heal this node. Oh, and you could get a surgery for it, which cuts it out. But there was like a 4% chance of losing your voice forever. And I was like, ah, I'm not doing it. I was like, I will try to heal it naturally. And that's when I started to really pick up the guitar again, which recently has become like a real love story. Like I just really want to like take it really serious and take it up a level.
Yeah.
And I'm sure we'll get into that kind of stuff. But from production, like, I don't know, dude. I feel like there's emotions and vibes that I can't reach with words. Like, mm-hmm. I can't. It's a different kind of expression. Like, Killa Kela podcast. Killa Kela official.com.
Street Culture TV.
Beatbox created. Killa Kela. And we're here to talk about world music and street culture.
Killa Kela podcast.
Ladies and gentlemen, Killa Kela podcast live and direct Central London, or Central as what? Central as you need to be. Trust me, baby pie, you don't need to be anywhere else. 500 God knows episodes and all of them packed with all the vitamins and vitality that you need to get yourself through the day and live a prosperous and happy life. Street culture is where it's at. Our sponsors, the mighty GK Nifty Heads, have a massive 100,000 play to earn NFTs to give away to the streets. Just hit the link in the description or go to gknifty.com and get ready for HODL Wars Summer 2024. But they don't just stay here in London. We're going transatlantic to a place called Boston, Massachusetts, to meet a gentleman, which I could say I'm probably one of the first people to discover the guy. And you know, when it comes to good talent, I like to bring it in. So we're bringing it in for the first time. I do believe it's his first podcast as well. If you are in any way in search of good music, can you discover this gentleman? It's rap, it's highest and awesome as well. Producer, MC, guitarist, well-versed in what he does, and is here to talk to us. I'm so stoked because I'm a fan first. Connor Cassidy in the building. What are we saying, my brother? Let's talk about this.
Oh, dude, life is good, dude. We're in home base right now, so this is where it all happens. I'm blown away the Jura fan from across the pond. I've actually never toured London before, so this is kind of cool.
It must be a trip having your music transferred over here in such a way, and it's quite alien, isn't it? Like, you don't actually know often how far your music or whatnot resonates, right?
Yeah, I think the magic of it is not lost on me. I think like I've never been to London. So it's not like I just haven't toured there. I've never been. So I'm excited to have my mind expanded by you, but also by London in general.
You've been over here yet?
No, never. Damn. Been to Ireland, half Irish. Have not been to London.
Big up our Irish crew that was definitely in the place. Boston holds a big Irish community, don't they, over there?
Oh, yeah. Most of us.
When did it all begin for you, my brother? I've noticed that you're a keen guitarist as well.
Yeah, I started really, really young. I remember being in high school, being like the guy who was selling mixtapes and trying to get kids to go to shows in the city and stuff. Mm. When I look back on it, it's pretty rare, like to be like 14 and like trying to pack a bar, because I remember I had to get like parental permission to go play the show, because we would get venues where I would get booked as like I'd be like 8 artists on it and I would freestyle or I would do whatever. And then like there were some other small things just like school related where I would like play guitar for a girl who was singing or something like that. Or I would try to, you know, seduce whatever love I was chasing at the time with the guitar. So those were like really early memories. It got serious when I was like 18, I want to say, which is now a long time ago. Mm-hmm. But then I have a weird story because I had like a big falling out with music.
Oh, really?
I had a vocal node on my vocals.
Oh, shit.
I was like 18, 19. Mm. The way it worked is there was a kid who was much more popping than I was when I had this happen. And I was like trying to make life decisions. I was like, should I go to school? Like, what should I do here? And I ended up managing this guy and we ended up touring and I toured as the manager. So I was actually on the business side in like my adult life first. And then to make a long story very short, we fell out and then I was like, you know what, dude, I still have this and I love this. I should do this. And then I just started cutting records and getting back into it. And when I look back on it, it feels like a whole kind of different life because it's just so much time. Like I graduated school, studied finance at Northeastern, went to UMiami for a little bit, So I was always like in between lives. I just recently left the job where I worked at Tesla full time. So I was at Tesla all the time.
Wow.
Yeah, which is funny because I don't think a lot of people like know this shit. Cause like I'm not very like vocal about this. Like I just kind of made it. Yeah, like I'm catching such a vibe with the music now that I'm like, dude, like I don't know. I don't even really know where it comes from. I have like such a synthetic, like I don't know. I like have such a memory trace of so many places that like now that I'm focused on music, it's like, dude, I didn't even know that was in there.
Yeah, I think there is something in the way of us being conduits when music's involved. It's like it already exists almost. We're just like plugging in, we're tuning into it. And that can encapture, inspire you as well. Like I can imagine for Connor Cassidy, it's like you're, cause you produce as well. You produce yourself.
Yeah.
And see, and that's the thing. You've got to have so many different heads. I can imagine Tesla were rapidly becoming like putting the back burner, right?
Well, dude, it's funny because like I aspire to be like a great man. And I think that's the driving force of life for me. Like I really have reverence for people that are creators and doers and thinkers. And like, yeah, I was kind of in the pandemic, like wrapping my mind around the whole Elon thing, but like really taking it serious, like going into the books and the technology. And I was like, okay, can't tour now. Might as well go get a job. Ended up getting a job. And like, it's kind of like you said at the beginning with like an obsessive taste with music. I'm like that in life. So like, if I grip something, I get like really serious about it. So dude, I'm ended up like, you know, like I made all those records while I was working there. And I caught such a flow of like the matrix of it. I was like really like, we're talking like double overtime, 7 days a week, cutting the records in between me sleeping and going to work. So I was like,
what? Dude.
Yeah, yeah. So this is like a really, I just closed that chapter. So I left 2 weeks ago. But yeah, it felt very much like the Matrix. I was like, this is weird.
It's a double life sort of thing.
Yeah, yeah. Kind of the Bruce Wayne thing going on.
Wow. Yeah. Did any of your work colleagues know that you were having this double life?
Yeah, it started becoming, I don't remember advertising it. I remember people finding the music and then me coming in and like hearing it blast in the shops. And I'd be like, oh, that's cool. People are like soldering metal and listening to Godspeed. And I'm like, that's a vibe. Cool. Yeah. Salute, guys. But it was a weird distance because like Tesla's a big company. There's like, I think in our region, there's like 500 of us. So like, wow. It's big, but it's small enough for word to travel. So people started like, yeah, I just started meeting like different people who were much more technical in service and like automotive being like, yo, I bump your shit. I'm like, that's what's up.
Do you think there's something in that where, you know, because I've got to say the kind of music you create, it's got a drive to it. It's got a pace to it. Do you think that has a play to it? You know, working within those environments, lifestyle sort of things, some of it can be aspirational, but at the same time, you know what I mean? You're getting a good wage. You're working for a car company. And of course, like the music you're going to create has a sense of opulence and maybe a power behind the machine. You know what I mean? Like car music.
Yeah, bro. Grind music. Like let's get after it. Like I want to, when we talk about soundtracking, like bro, I'm in the gym. I'm you're behind the wheel starting your business. Like I want people to like get motivated. I don't know. I just feel like I that's how I feel. And I'm like, dude, like I've had people call me with Godspeed. I had a reverend in like South Carolina call me every morning, tell me he was like playing that Godspeed, joined his church. I was like, really? I was like, nope. I was like, send me a video of that. And he did. And I was like, holy shit, dude. It's like crazy to like be on an indie level and have those things happen.
Well, yeah. But like I said to you before we started, I listen to your stuff on the underground tubes. There's a sense of pace to it, sense of celebration. I think that's where you're coming from. It's this constant salute to oneself and the performance that they want to give, that you want to give yourself, right?
It's like a God is glorious vibe, I think.
Yeah,
I get. Like, but I don't know, dude, because I'm not objective because I'm me. Like there were moments in studio sessions. Like I had a joint called Family that I was going to throw away. And then my engineer was like, no, he was like, you can't. He's like, you can't throw it away. And I was like, what are you talking about? He's like, dude, go breathe. Like, you have a boxing match later this month. Listen to it up until the match. Once the match is over, you tell me if you want to throw it out or not. And I did. I lived with it and sat with it and marinated. And I was like, all right, maybe this could be meaningful to somebody, which I think at the end of the day is what the whole point is. Like, I was like, all right, it's not, maybe it's not my say. You know what I mean?
So do you box as well? You're a boxer?
Yeah. There was a time where that was going to be a real career. I was like,
really?
Cause I had two amateur fights and I was like, those went well. I was like, I went up against the kid in the gym at the time who was named Andre the Giant. We packed the house out. Very Boston, South Boston boxing. That's kind of where I like trained and got my chops. And yeah, I remember coming out of those fights, and I think I was in school at the time, but I was getting such an energy from the boxing environment. I was like, dude, I could fuck. I got this, dude, for sure. And I remember getting a lot of respect from that fight because we did, I think, like, I want to say like 9 rounds at midnight. And I still have the tape of the fight.
Really?
Very, very amateur, but still enough for me to be like, yeah, that could be a real thing.
So you said it's the power behind, see all these things that come into play when you're creating song and track and production. All of these things, athleticism, performance, drive. That's what I get, particularly from songs like Godspeed. That kind of Isley Brothers kind of vibe, which is ethereal, quite an ethereal tone to it. Mm. Yeah, man, I get you. How do you tell me about the headspace of going from producer to lyricist? How do you go from one to the other?
Well, so when I had the vocal node thing happen, it was really kind of heartbreaking because I was like, I can't record. I can't really. There were days and weeks where I couldn't even talk because I had to try to heal this node. Oh, and you could get a surgery for it, which cuts it out. But there was like a 4% chance of losing your voice forever. And I was like, I'm not doing it. I was like, I will try to heal it now. And that's when I started to really pick up the guitar again, which recently has become like a real love story. Like, I just really want to like take it really serious and take it up a level.
Yeah.
And I'm sure we'll get into that kind of stuff. But from production, like, I don't know, dude, I feel like there's emotions and vibes that I can't reach with words. Like, mm-hmm. I can't, it's a different kind of expression. Like, for me, it's almost deeper because it's like not really like solid. Like, I can, if I'm feeling like, I don't know, I'm really into a lot of the metal bands that are coming up right now. And like, there's a certain like aggression and just like fuck you vibe going on that I'm just like, I've seen it before with Slipknot and those bands, but like seeing it again in like a modern version, which like combines electronics, like I'm talking bands like Bad Omens, Sleep Token. Those guys are the ones that I'm listening to right now.
Yeah. I got you.
Yeah. And you just can't do it with just words. Like it's such a huge, like, so yeah, that's kind of a long-winded answer to the thing. I just think there's different ways to communicate. And sometimes I get a bigger kick from beats than I do from words, but I do love words.
And this is, I'm going somewhere with this. It feels like when I hear you spit, or I hear one of your songs, not only do I feel like there is a sense of self-awareness with the branding. It's almost like Esquire chic, you know, like that kind of magazine kind of gentleman's FHM, that kind of thing. And then the sound itself is very unique.
It trips me out to hear it because I think I just get caught up in what I think is like inspiring in the moment. It's hard for me to know, to be honest. I just like, I do feel that I'm being pulled by the universe towards something. I just don't know what that is. I've watched it uncover piece by piece, song by song. I feel like a sound is like pulling me. It's almost like a gravity type thing.
Really?
Yeah, because that's what I feel like. I don't know. I'll get a little metaphysical for a second. I feel like we're put here to do things, and I've lived like a couple different lives, and I'm not going to escape what I'm meant to do, if that makes sense. Like, I'm not going to, you cannot run from your purpose. So I'm being pulled towards something. I have no clue what it is. I've given up trying to figure it out. It's not my job to figure it out. It's my job to just, you know, we don't get to choose these things. These happen to us. And I just hope that I can fulfill my task, and whatever that ends up being or whatever. Yeah. I pray that I can make it happen.
Wow. Is that why you're going at it full time with the music now? Because of that?
Yeah, because I've had moments that just like kind of expand the vision of what this is for. Like, I remember receiving a bunch of videos after the family song came out of people like rejoining with their kids, or like on the other side, there were like vets who were coming home from like overseas to like meet their. I was like, whoa, dude. And my buddy who was helping manage me at the time, but is no longer, pulled up like a data sheet and was like, dude, like this is jamming in like the military bases of South Carolina. Like you should look at this.
Yeah,
and I was
yeah,
like,
yeah.
Huh. And I was like trying to, cause when you're an indie artist, you're like figuring out data and all this kind of stuff. Yeah. And I was like, whoa. Like, and I started getting like training videos of people in military camps. I was like, what? I was like, hold on a second. And I'm meanwhile, like I'm in my life, right? But like, I'm trying to like get my mind around everybody else's experience and kind of like expand my sense of empathy about what this means. I'm like, okay, all right. I don't know where it, as I mentioned, I don't know where it's going, but I think my job is not to know where it's going. I think my job is to just take it there.
Yeah. How many songs would you say you've amassed in the studio at the moment that we haven't heard out yet?
I'd probably say like 120 that I'm confident on.
Really? Stop it. 120.
Yeah, I have a real problem finishing, but the ideas are so like, it's funny, like that's why it's reaffirming my belief that I don't know the, like, I just don't know God's plan for all this. Like,
right.
Because if I'm given an idea and then I live with it, it's like, dude, you get like really paranoid living with the songs. Cause you're like, I just don't know what this is going to mean. Like, that's why it's such a trip for me to hear you talk about it. I'm like, dude, this clearly means something to him. Like,
I
can fall, like, I'm a human being. Like, I can fall in like pockets of me, like looking at my, like, I don't know, my life situation, or like when I quit my job, everyone was like, what the fuck? Like, you're going to leave all this stock on the table and you're going to lose your health care. And all this. And I was like, bro, I don't give a fuck. Like, there's a different, I've just had too many experiences that move me in the direction of this being a responsibility for me to be like, but it is making me paranoid with the records. Cause it's like, you can't live with pressure, but you do have to have like a fire behind you that's like, all right. So I'm excited to hear what you think, dude. I got some in the case that I'm like, I think these are much better.
Throw it in the chamber, baby.
That's right. You stay loaded.
I find the whole journey of art history extremely curious. And I think a lot of people have their own reasons and practices. Some works for them really well, others don't. I think there's a lot to be said for when you stop working in your normal job and the anxiety, fear, the pressure, the expectation on you and other people, you know, the naysayers right through to the cheerleaders, you know, it's all of those things. It's like you're going down a hill with the stabilizers off your bike. Right. Mm. But that's what makes the good music.
Yeah. Dude, we'll see. I definitely, it's definitely not for me to decide, but I'm excited to see. Yeah. Like I forget who said this, but it moved me. It's like when you release stuff, it becomes ours, not mine, right? So like right now it's mine. That's why it's driving me crazy. But as soon as it's ours, it's like, okay, awesome. And people are going to find things that you didn't even intend. Like, but then at the end of the day, like I think Rick Rubin said it. It's like artists spend years trying to figure out what they made. Right.
Yeah.
That's like, we don't really know what we made here.
Yeah.
It's I definitely so true. Had that experience with Godspeed for sure. I was like, oh, this is cool. And then it went out and I was like, holy fuck. Like people really found like a, and then I re-listened to it and I started to find the same thing that they found. And I was like, oh, great.
Yeah. But you know what though, as well, and I'm sticking with Godspeed for a second, because it also allows you to fill the blanks in certain, it's like you're handing over an idea they told me sky's a limit, turns out my mother lied. It's like, all right, son, so your mum lied down. That is that the is that the theory of it?
Say it again.
Well, you said it's his lyrics.
Yeah, yeah.
They say the sky's the limit, turns out my mother lied. Now I'm only guessing you meant by laying down, that, you know, terminology. Is that what you were thinking?
I don't think so. I think I was thinking, tough for me to know, but I think I was thinking like interstellar travel is possible. Like she lied. It's just like we,
yo,
like it's a limited vision of who we are. Like, I think that's where I caught the bug of the whole Tesla universe, because I was like, these people are taking space technology and using it to make cars. That's badass.
Like, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, yeah. Yeah.
Firmly
yeah.
on the side of people that want to go do big, epic, crazy, current zeitgeist breaking stuff.
Overly ambitious to most, but it's so in the group. I know exactly what you mean.
Yeah, like illogical from the current culture, but from a cosmic perspective, like, dude, generations after us are going to be counting on us to get us out of here. So
yeah,
better start now.
Do you believe that, Connor? Do you believe that that's the case?
I generally buy the argument that it is imperative for us to explore the universe.
Okay.
And if we don't put urgency on it, it will not happen. We have, people forget, in the United States, the space program had a 40-year decline, not an increase. We went to the moon and they didn't go back. So aerospace was kind of a neglected space of our infrastructure until companies like SpaceX came along and kind of put a fire under the ass of the industry. Like, this is me getting more on my industrial side, but like, this is the stuff that I read and I'm a fan of, and in some ways I'm connected to.
Yeah.
Yeah. We like, technology doesn't evolve unless we work and have missions that force it to evolve. So like, I think it's factual that the Earth has a finite lifespan. So to ensure the ongoing existence of consciousness, I do echo the sentiment that we have to travel. I don't claim to be smart enough to know the specifics of what that means, but I do know that either there's been no other civilization on a distant planet that's made it out of its own galaxy far enough to reach us, or there isn't, and we're the only ones, which makes it even scarier.
That does make it even more daunting.
We need to be one of the civilizations that makes it beyond. And yeah, who knows how we will evolve.
But doing it, moving into interplanetary worlds for the good of our future young people in discovery, bigger than the Earth, going that distance, and heck, maybe even extending our lives.
Tough to know. What if there's stuff out there that we can't imagine? Like, I just think the pioneering aspect of it, the same reason human beings went west when we didn't know what was here, is the same reason we need to go out. And we need to go in. We have a lot to figure out about ourselves as well, but we also must physically go out. Both as an insurance policy on consciousness, but also more so to explore.
Oh God, you are so hitting so many things with me right now. This is sick. So, okay, you said something about the inners, you know, fixing ourselves internally. Everything. Space. It's a mirror reflection, literally, of our physical, our surroundings, fixing ourselves to begin with. Do you think, this is Ash's level of wisdom here, who knows, if we fix ourselves, fix the world, fix all of these internal emotional problems that we have, that block, you think that blockage would clear and then we would have more vision in our environments and, you know, the calcified minds of the majority would, you know, would unseize, and then we're visualizing things maybe to the same level in which you're the conduit for your music. Perhaps there's an argument that, yeah, sure, we can go out, but first of all, you know, you got to free your mind so your ass can follow, right?
Yeah, I can speak subjectively. Like, I think this is a giant, life is like a giant self-discovery thing. Like, we don't really know who we are, I don't think. Mm-hmm. Not in its entirety. Like, I'm always looking at like all these books and being like, who would I be on the other side of understanding all that? Like, I have no idea.
That's so sick you think that way, though. I love it.
You know what I mean? Like, who, in your current definition, like, would you even... I think I said this to, like, an ex-girlfriend, which is a weird example. But I was like, I have a much better time here on this little sphere when I'm not thinking about me. Like, when it's... Like, how much have I really invested into, like, empathetic muscle? Like, Obama had a great... bar where he was like, libraries are like citadels of empathy. And what he was trying to say is like, you wow. know, how much have we really dissolved ourselves in the collective experience? My subjective answer for this moment in time would be less than ever. Like, we are very like, I don't know. It feels like the culture is like very self-obsessive and
self-obsessive for sure.
Individual, and like, we have to be the most narcissistic generation ever.
Yeah.
Tough to know, though, because they didn't have phones back then. But yeah, anyway, I'm going off the rails a little bit. But the point I was trying to make was just like, I think it's a process of getting to know who we are. I think that's what life is.
You know, when musicians, artists, you know, we do have free reign to kind of think these through. And in many respects, kind of be 6 months ahead of the curve on a lot of forecasting of like what's going on in society and stuff, don't you think?
I think the job or the office of the ideal from an artist perspective is to like completely go the other way if it's merited.
Yeah.
And be like, you know what? I like there's statements I make in some of the new music that I'm like, this is how I fucking feel. I don't know if anybody else feels this way. We're gonna find out. We're gonna figure out if it resonates. But yeah, like my view, and I say me because just from an artistic lens looking out, but anyone who's in that space or is trying to create something, I think value statements shouldn't have any consideration for what anybody else is thinking. I think it should just be, you know, this is how I'm seeing it.
Yeah.
And then, you know, once the music becomes ours, maybe that's how other people feel too. Maybe not, but I don't know. Only way to find out is to find out.
Yeah, true. And once that music goes out, there's, you know, fully circling back around on what we initially talked about, you know, me being captivated, you know, grabbing the tunes that you're transmitting. Like, sometimes you just got to let them go. And where they go, you have no idea.
Yeah, there's like, yeah, I have no idea. I know that upon second listen, Godspeed went in the boxing rotation. I'm in the gym like training to that now, and I'm like, this is cool. I'm like, I get it now. I didn't get it at the time, but I get it now.
Tell us about the future, my brother. What you got coming up?
So I have this Nashville trip that I need to make. So there's a There was a drummer named Cole Calise, who, in my opinion, is going to be the best drummer in the world. But we linked up in Boston when he was studying at Berkeley. We did a bunch of sessions together. From there, we started writing all these rock tunes.
Nice.
And I need to close that loop. Like, I need, he's living down in Nashville now, gigging. I'm going to go down there and basically show up with whatever money I have in a car and a guitar and be like, we're making this album. Like, I'm not leaving here until we finish the rock album. So what I'm going to do is do like five videos in the hip hop album here first.
Nice.
And then I'm going to book it to Nashville and do that. So like, at least the world and the streets have something that's up here that's done that I just need to ship. Mm-hmm. And then get to Nashville, we get to get really kind of like in the weeds of the next chapter, which in my opinion is live bands, forming the group. I'll let this be a casting call for the internet. We are recruiting, okay? We are looking for the we are looking for great players who want to make an extremely new rock sound. That's what we're trying to do.
Get it in. I love it.
That's the mission. That's what I'm committed to. That's what's scratching the itch. I'm chasing the back of these guys, man. I'm seeing the Sleep Token stuff, the Bad Omen stuff. I'm like, this shit is fucking cool, dude.
Yeah.
I'm like, I am down to disciple it all the way. We are building a similar but different vibe.
More power to you, Connor. That's fucking great. And yeah, look forward to hearing some more tunes in the future.
No doubt, dude. Appreciate you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Killa Kela podcast. Out like it was out of fashion. Connor Cassidy tells you so. Boston, hold tight. Yo, sharing is caring. Tell a friend to tell a friend. And yeah, if you don't know, get to know. Stay lucky, people. Don't talk to an I wouldn't. Peace.